from the tree base. Again the flash of flame went through the young soldier, seeing the stiff body stoop beneath him, and his hands jerked. He looked away. He could feel the officer was nervous. The bread fell as it was being broken. The officer ate the other piece. The two men stood tense and still, the master laboriously chewing his bread, the servant staring with averted face, his fist clenched. Then the young soldier started. The officer had pressed open the lid of the mug again. The orderly watched the lid of the mug and the white hand that clenched the handle as if he were fascinated. It was raised. The youth followed it with his eyes, and then he saw the thin, strong throat of the elder man moving up and down as he drank, the strong jaw working. And the instinct which had been jerking at the young man's wrists suddenly jerked free. He jumped, feeling as if it were rent in two by a strong flame. The spur of the officer caught in a tree root. He went down backwards with a crash, the middle of his back thudding sickeningly against a sharp-edged tree base, the pot flying away. And in a second, the orderly, with serious, earnest young face and underlip between his teeth, had got his knee in the officer's chest and was pressing the chin backward over the farther edge of the tree stump, pressing with all his heart behind in a passion of relief, the tension of his wrists exquisite with relief. And with the base of his palms, he shoved at the chin with all his might. And it was pleasant, too, to have that chin, that hard jaw, always slightly rough with beard in his hands. He did not relax one hair's breadth, but, all the force of all his blood exulting in his thrust, he shoved back the head of the other man, till there was a little clunk and a crunching sensation. Then he felt as if his head went to vapour. Heavy convulsions shook the body of the officer, frightening and horrifying the young soldier. Yet it pleased him, too, to repress them. It pleased him to keep his hands pressing back the chin, to feel the chest of the other man yield in expiration to the weight of his strong young knees, to feel the hard twitchings of the prostrate body jerking his own whole frame, which was pressed down on it. But it went still. He could look into the nostrils of the other man, the eyes he could scarcely see. How curiously the mouth was pushed out, exaggerating the full lips and the moustache bristling up from them. Then, with a start, he noticed the nostrils gradually filling with blood. The red brimmed, hesitated, ran over, and went in a thin trickle down the face to the eyes. It shocked and distressed him. Slowly, he got up. The body twitched and sprawled there inert. He stood and looked at it in silence. It was a pity it was broken. It represented more than the thing which had kicked and